Hello. Welcome on behalf of Sydney Conservatorium of Music. And first let me present apologies from our Dean, Professor Anna Reid, who has asked me to extend a very warm welcome to everyone here. I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which we stand and to express our respects to elders past, present and future of the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation. Tonight's lecture, in addition to the keynote address for the Musicological Society of Australia, is also an Alfred Hook lecture. And I thought I'd give you some brief background about Alfred Hook. Alfred Samuel Hook, 1886 to 1963, contributed to the foundation of the Faculty of Architecture here at the University of Sydney, which was founded in 1918, and subsequently to the development of its curriculum. He lectured there from 1922. He was a man of diverse talents, and in addition to his many activities in architecture, he was a member of the Sydney University Musical Society's choral group and a keen amateur organist who was associated with the installation of the university's war memorial carillon that some of you may have heard. He was also instrumental in the foundation of the University of Sydney's Department of Music in 1948. From 1936 to 1945 he gave regular lunch hour talks on the history of music using gramophone records given to the university by the Carnegie Corporation of New York. And so it's in his honour that the Sydney Conservatorium of Music's Alfred Hook Lecture Series is named. And it was established with the generous bequest from the estate of the late Doreen Robson. Let me now turn to introducing our speaker, Professor Gary Tomlinson. Gary is the John Hay Whitney Professor of Music and Humanities at Yale University and director of the Whitney Humanities Centre there. He's a musicologist and cultural theorist whose teaching and scholarship have ranged across diverse fields, including the history of opera, early modern European musical thought and practice, the musical cultures of indigenous American societies, jazz and popular music, and the philosophy of history and critical theory. His books include Monteverdi and the End of the Renaissance, Music in Renaissance Magic, Metaphysical Song, an essay on opera, The Singing of the New World, Indigenous Voice in the Era of European Contact, and Music and Historical Critique. He's the co-author with Joseph Kerman of the music textbook Listen, which is now in its 8th edition. Tomlinson's latest research concerns music and human evolution. His most recent book, A Million Years of Music, The Emergence of Human Modernity, published jointly by Zone Books and MIT Press in 2015, weaves evidence from archaeology, cognitive studies, evolutionary theory, and other fields into a new narrative of the emergence of human musicking capacities. Tomlinson numbers a MacArthur Fellowship and nomination to the American Academy of Arts and Sciences among many awards. He's garnered prizes and fellowships also from the American Musicological Society, the American Society of Composers, Authors, and Publishers, the Modern Language Association, the British Academy, and the Guggenheim Foundation. Please join me in welcoming to the podium Gary Tomlinson to deliver this year's.
Sound like I'm mic'd. You can hear me in the back, I trust. I want first also to pay my respects to the elders past, present, and future of the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, whose land I'm standing on. I want to express what an honor it is for me to be giving the Alfred Hook Lecture, to be giving a keynote talk simultaneously for the Musicological Society of Australia, where I've been delighted to hear wonderful presentations, wonderful concerts, conversations over the last 2 days, to take part indeed in the University of Sydney's celebration of the 100th anniversary of the Sydney Conservatorium, whose joint scholarly and performance energies I've also been marveling at for these last 2 days since I arrived. I want to thank the many organizers of this meeting, and I want to particularly to pay my thanks, again, to extend my thanks to Linda Barwick, who set in motion my invitation. Almost a half century ago, the British ethnomusicologist John Blacking asked, "How musical is man?" And the gesture, though it came in a small book, was grand and sweeping, an important moment in the disciplinary ferment that defines several kinds of musical study now practiced in universities around the globe. If today his question seems to have shrunk in size, it's because we take the answer he reached for granted. How musical are we? Very musical. Fundamentally musical. This is clear. And musical down to deep levels of our social and cultural makeup. This too is clear. Our own inquiries start from here and move in other directions. How did humans come to be musical? What is the interplay of the several vectors of this musicality, cultural, cognitive, developmental, evolutionary? And what entailments does our musicality show with other characteristic human capacities? Today, I want to describe how I've tried in recent work to approach these questions. Along the way, I'll say something general about the place of music in our lives, which is one that shows little sign of disappearing, at least at a general level, or indeed changing much in its outlines. But I'll also try to push the questioning farther. For to speak of the place of music is not to speak only of a metaphorical place, the locations we all find in the expressive cultures that humans construct. It's also to speak of a real place, of a human inhabiting of the world, even of our niche in the biosphere, and indeed the traditional owners of this land knew that better than most peoples. And it is to understand music as an active force fashioning this niche, to describe in other words, our musicking into being of a habitation. How humans do this is unique, I think, notwithstanding the spectacularly complex things many other animals do, some of which we choose also to think of as music or song. But we need to ponder this uniqueness. Seen in proper perspective, it is not the incentive to celebrate human exceptionalism that it might be taken to be. Instead, it beckons unexpectedly toward a lived experience broader than the human alone, broader indeed than that of all the putatively musical or songful animals in the world. This is a point to which I will return later in my lecture, for I believe it can have a role to play in altering our thought about the human niche in general. And the project of such alteration, it need hardly be said, presses urgently upon us. To appreciate how our habitation is musically made, we must look far back in our past. The reasons for this assertion will become clear in what follows. This deep historical perspective takes in the modernity of Homo sapiens in relation to other pre-modern hominin groups and species. It is a modernity measured as paleoanthropologists do, not in decades or even centuries, but in tens of thousands of years. This is a period long enough to encompass significant evolutionary changes in our species and to witness its development from a collection of scattered African lineages to a homogenized world population dominating the biosphere. The long period witnessed also the intertwining of biology and culture in our evolution, and one result of looking out across this long period is to shine a biocultural light on analyses that might otherwise appear purely cultural. We may happily, and by the way, legitimately, choose to concentrate on specific global cultures. Most musicology does so. But the long view shows that any clear boundary between nature and nurture is an artifact of foreshortened perspectives and nothing more. Here's another place where our thinking has shifted since John Blacking's day. The deep biocultural history of musicking has been the object of my research, as you heard Linda say, for some years now, and a full formulation of the case as I see it came out in that book, A Million Years of Music. There, I describe how, over a period five times longer than the span of our species. Hominin cultures played an increasing role in shaping hominin lived experience, and hence an increasing role in shaping hominin niches and the dynamics of natural selection at work in them. Niche construction, biologists call this alteration by organisms of the environments that determine their selective advantage. All organisms construct their niches in some degree, whether or not they are culture-making organisms. But the fact that culture has played a huge, unprecedented role in the niche construction of hominins explains why we need a biocultural approach to their evolution. In regard to musicking, my effort was to discern within human niche construction the incremental components of musical capacities taking shape long before musicking as such could have existed. And then to describe the increments coming together, coalescing into modern musical capacities and behaviors. This long-term incrementalism is, I think, essential to understanding all the fundamental things that humans do, from music to language, complex technology, and the fashioning of a metaphysical imaginary. In effect, incremental analysis pulls apart our complex behaviors into their components, which admit of plausible adaptive hypotheses earlier in our evolution. So instead of asking, what selective advantage did music as a whole offer? A question that puzzled Darwin already and has been a stumbling block ever since. We ask, for instance, how did precise rhythmic entrainment come to confer selective advantage? Or how did the perception of discrete pitch emerge from a vocal communication involving sliding graded intonations? Once we isolate the various increments, the component parts solidifying through the selective advantages they carry with them, their ultimate coalescence into complex behaviors requires its own description, one that also cannot dispense with fundamental processes of natural selection. Only here can the non-incremental question, why music as a whole, be productively asked. In my view, the merger of the increments came late for musicking, as it did also for language and metaphysical thought, probably within the last 100,000 years. These mergers were not separate events, but interdependent ones involving evolutionary processes that have been changed subtly by the expanding role of culture. But I'm getting ahead of myself. If we look back over the last half million years now, two general trends in the evolution of hominins appear. Cognitive archaeologists have discerned these working in very nuanced ways with the material remains of hominin societies. These trends are sporadic and uneven and divided across several or indeed many species, but they trace in their jagged way a growth curve. The first trend is toward more and more complex cultures, toward an accumulation of depth and intricacy in the bodies of learned knowledge and practice that hominins transmitted across generations. Here, by the way, there is an implicit broad definition of culture, one that extends it to many animals besides hominins. Culture is the transmitting to future generations of knowledge and practice learned during a lifetime. The second trend came along hand in hand with this cultural deepening, and its importance can hardly be overstated. It was a growing capacity for what has been variously called offline thinking, or a release from proximity, or thinking at a distance. Hominins were more and more loosed from the cage of immediate experience restricted to sense perceptions and the here and now. This release involved an ability to think about the past and also to see the future, so to speak, in the planning of actions and the safeguarding for contingencies yet to come. Archaeologists have traced the growth of thinking at a distance in several ways. Hominins came to transport materials over increasing geographical distances, apparently planning farther into the future for their use. They began exchanging materials with other groups, lengthening their transport even farther. They stopped making new tools each time they needed them and instead carried tools with them to be reused. Even the sequences of operations by which they made their tools grew longer as pre-manufacture planning extended its reach into the future. At a certain point also, these tool-making operational sequences grew not only in length, but also in the networked intricacy of their organization. This begins to be well attested in the technologies of our Neanderthal cousins from at least 250,000 years ago. The sequences took on a new kind of complexity in two ways. First, the individual gestures in them differentiated themselves into distinct kinds of gestures. grouped together in the process of manufacture. These distinct kinds of gestures had to be followed in a particular order to achieve the desired product. In other words, a nested hierarchy of procedures came to organize the manufacture. Second, composite tools became more and more common. Instead of a simple stone hand axe, now a stone point was produced that had to be affixed to a wooden shaft, produced with its own procedural sequence, using adhesives and straps of leather or brass, also produced with their sequences. Composite tools carried hierarchic construction to a new level, manifesting a combinatoriality in which components were separately designed for later assembly. We can see that thinking at a distance expanded in several directions, even in the fragmentary reflection of it we have. In a few moments, I'll identify another related direction. Meanwhile, glancing ahead, we can see also that the expansions of cognitive capacities for hierarchization and for discrete combinatoriality are of special interest to us, since neither language nor musicking in their modern forms could exist without both. Step back again 500,000 years now and listen to a group of hominins gathered to butcher a hippopotamus carcass, a circumstance revealed to us in a very well-studied site at Box Grove, England. The group we're eavesdropping on is probably a band of Homo heidelbergensis, the progenitors of Neanderthals in Europe. We, Homo sapiens, are still about 300,000 years in the future. The communications of this group are complex as its members coordinate many tasks, gathering stones from a nearby bluff, fashioning tools from those stones, cutting and stripping flesh, disjointing and dismembering, smashing bones, consuming on the spot what could not be carried away, dividing the spoils, all the while warding off four-legged and winged scavengers looking to get their own piece of the action. The communications involved in this scene have been termed proto-discourse, a useful term in my view, not least for its avoidance of this early period of the term proto-language. Proto-discourse, in the general outline so that we can reconstruct, was nothing like modern language, but was instead a stage between it and the gesture calls we see in primates in the wild today. It involved both vocal and bodily signs, pointing indications, signals of affective states, signals to make others behave as the signaler wished. The vocal signs depended on varied articulations, intonations, amplitudes, and timbres. But of words and grammar, there was as yet no hint. The operations of these vocal signs, in the terms of Charles Sanders Peirce's well-known trio of icons, indexes, and symbols, was not symbolic, but mostly not iconic, but instead indexical. Now, an index is a sign that derives its meaning from its immediate surroundings, from its relation with things close at hand. Indexes function by indication, by pointing or deixis, by direct connection to what they mean, or by causal relation to what they mean. Proto-discourse was a communicative world of indexes, indexes of affect, of directing others, and of simple actions in and on the world. Now, indexes are familiar to musicologists because they are the kind of sign basic to today's musicking. That is to say, the meaning of musical signs is mostly a matter of relations within a context and of pointing implications from one sign to another one more or less nearby. Musical scholars in a line reaching almost back to the time of Peirce himself have remarked on and scrutinized this indexicality. Already in 1944, Suzanne Langer, in Philosophy in a New Key, employed Peircean categories as she worked to carry further Edward Hanslick's musical formalism from the 19th century and to distinguish music from symbolic modes such as language. Langer exercised a strong influence then on Leonard Meyer, especially on his watershed study of the 1950s, Emotion and Meaning in Music. And together, Langer and Meyer initiated a whole genealogy of scholars emphasizing the indexicality of musical expression and perception. Members of this family tree who have in recent years taken an explicit Peircean orientation include ethnomusicologist Tom Torino, philosopher Charles Nussbaum, and especially the late Australian music theorist Naomi Cumming. Even positions less explicitly Peircean show on closer inspection their connection to the tree. The so-called implication realization model of Meyer's student Eugene Garmer is an immense and careful elaboration of music's indexicality. Strong Peircean premises inhabit the generative model of Fred Lairdal and Ray Jackendoff, and the expectational music psychology of David Huron. Further afield still, Theodor Adorno, the great Frankfurt School critique master. Theodor Adorno's materialist aesthetics in music is filled with intimations of something akin to Peircean indexicality. Here's a characteristic passage defining the relation of musical form and content from Adorno. Musical content is the profusion of things which obey the rules of musical grammar and syntax. Every musical phenomenon points to something beyond itself by reminding us of something, contrasting itself with something, or arousing our expectations. The summation of such transcendence of particulars constitutes the content. It is what happens in music. The efforts of all these theorists and analysts and musicologists in their various ways involve describing how musical signification is rooted in indexes rather than the symbol systems built in language. And in this overweening indexicality, modern musicking, then, is allied with our ancestors' proto-discourse, which relied on the burgeoning of a deictic and proximate signification long before symbolic cognition or human modernity had come. But let me be very clear here. I am not saying that proto-discourse was musical. It's a mistake, I think, often made. The hominins of Boxgrove butchering their hippopotamus could not command a whole range of cognitive processes that are fundamental to modern music and that have to do with the hierarchic and combinatorial formalizations I spoke of a few moments ago. These form what Adorno termed the musical grammar and syntax. So, in the long period from 500,000 to 60, 70, 80,000 years ago, from Homo heidelbergensis down to us, the developments between proto-discourse and modern musicking and speaking were many and complex. I sketched a model of them for musicking and suggested some aspects of them for language in A Million Years of Music. Regarding language, I spent some time outlining where I agree and disagree with paleolinguists, for they are, not surprisingly, a linguocentric lot. By which I mean that they tend to see things in linguistic terms before all else, hence tend to think that modern traits of humanity were all dependent on the prior achievement of language. Many of these paleolinguists are unapologetic human exceptionalists, and language, when it comes to separating the human from the non-human, is, after all, exhibit number one, for there's nothing much like it anywhere else in the animal kingdom today. But linguocentrism of this kind cannot well account for human musical capacities, which show deep-seated kinds of independence from linguistic capacities. Cognitivists are understanding this independence more and more clearly as the years go by. So the model I advocated in my book followed instead two separate parallel paths from proto-discourse, down here as the foundation, down the long road to musicking and speaking. We can call these paths then proto-language on the one hand, now we can use that term, and proto-music on the other. Both are developments out of and must be distinguished from proto-discourse. Proto-language gravitated towards semantic specification of the world and actions in it, which resulted ultimately in the predication and the argument operator structures of modern language. Proto-music, instead, marshaled hierarchic and combinatorial ordering of acoustic indexes toward a different end. It veered toward an acoustically ordered articulation of social activity that in several aspects could stand apart from everyday communication. These paths of proto-language and proto-music were not fully independent. Instead, they were wide enough to overlap at their near edges. Neither were they clearly defined paths at first. Instead, a confluence of subpaths made them clearer and clearer as time went by. The subpaths represent the increments I spoke of before. In addition, these paths crossed into the growing cognitive complexities of thinking at a distance. Proto-music and proto-language exploited the cognitive capacities associated with thinking at a distance, those capacities for hierarchical ordering and combinatorial fashioning of larger units out of arrays of smaller ones. They did not create these capacities, proto-music and proto-language, and conversely, the capacities did not create them. This is important. There is no single causal thread to follow in this evolutionary maze. Instead, an elaborated sociality, relying on communication of growing complexity, grew along with increasing cognitive abstraction. The two fed off of each other, the communication burgeoning in new formal possibilities, even as it extended the reach of thought farther and farther beyond social and sensual proximity. So one takeaway from all this regarding modern musicking and language is striking them in its implications. They were both, musicking and language, were both tied, long before they assumed their modern forms, to novel cognitive capacities for abstract formalization. The formalism of human expressive culture, in other words, was an aboriginal condition of human modernity. Let's follow this intersection of social complexity and thinking at a distance in one more direction not yet made. At some point before 100,000 years ago, among Homo sapiens and probably Neanderthals also, maybe indeed one or two other shadowy species that are only just now coming into life, at some point before 100,000 years ago, intricate sociality and the release from proximity together began to foster the movement of thought beyond the visible manifest aspects of social ordering toward invisible aspects. These were at first modest, extended kinship affiliations, for example, or differences of status assigned within the group. But even in modest forms, such invisible tokens of social position are noteworthy. They entail a separation of concepts from sense realities and from the momentary flux of transactions. The separation enables humans to create essentialized social roles assigned to people and groups, roles that exist and persist aside from the individuals assuming them. Concepts of a chieftain, for example, or a descent group, or a clan, or a nation, all give individuals identities not physically present in them. A baboon troop has none of these, however complex its negotiations of power and status. Anthropologist Maurice Bloch has analyzed this uniquely human kind of sociality. For him, it involves a top-down structuring overlaid on the bottom-up, face-to-face, step-by-step structuring we share with many other species, with those baboons, for example. Bloch calls this top-down organization transcendental sociality, looking to capture its invisible, nonsensical concepts. Transcendental sociality arises, he says, from our foundational capacity to imagine other worlds. In my turn, it's one more extension of thinking at a distance, the thinking whereby hominins first envisaged otherness in time and space, offline pasts, futures, and elsewheres. Transcendental sociality, moreover, is allied with the other outgrowths of thinking at a distance that I described before, the ones involving formalized cognition. Its essentialized social roles organize themselves, according to their top-down structuring, into hierarchies of status, for example, into nested sets of kinship, and into combinatorial memberships of many forms, family, clan, and so forth. Transcendental sociality was thus connected from the first to cognitive formalization. The two probably came about in mutual interaction. For Bloch, the systems of transcendental sociality are the source of the special complexity of interaction that humans construct. They guide social practice by organizing fleeting, palpable transactions according to invisible aspects. This connection of transactional then and transcendental modes, the bottom up with the top down, is found everywhere in human sociality. But it is manifested most clearly in ritual, by which I mean something very broad. Activities ranging from the most elaborate ceremony to humbler social performances. In ritual, transactions are formalized, deflecting their moment-to-moment intentionality away from their participants and onto a higher, enduring plane. We can begin to see now a connection between Bloch's transcendental sociality and the parallel paths of proto-music and proto-language, since these also took on, in their distinctive ways, hierarchized and combinatorial ordering. We are approaching here the tangled congeries that constitutes all human modernity, and has done so for at least the better part of 100,000 years. And we can clarify the relations of the ingredients of this modernity if we bring one last analysis of cultural forms to bear on them. This one offered by linguistic anthropologist Michael Silverstein. Silverstein distinguishes between the pragmatics of language and a separate higher level, its metapragmatics. Pragmatics is a matter of the performative aspects of language in context, its turn-taking, its pointing or deictic indications, those lexical things I was talking about. It's gestural and prosodic emphases and more. Metapragmatics, instead, involves all the overarching forms of order that marshal such elements, such pragmatic elements, into effective communication and effective discourse. Metapragmatics is a systematizing, in other words, of the performativity of language. It is necessary in all language, but it predominates, especially in formalized discourse, and most of all, for Silverstein, precisely in ritual. So we arrive at an important conjuncture of the ideas of Bloch and of Silverstein. For both of them, ritual involves formal systems that point toward a meta-level, toward the transcendence of immediate transactional performance. But this is not all. The performative aspects of language marshaled in Silverstein's metapragmatics are mostly nothing other than its indexical aspects, in contrast to the symbolism of its words and grammar. The systematizing of metapragmatics, then, is a systematizing of indexes. Ritual itself, in all its myriad richness, may be seen as the culmination in human experience of formalized indexicality. Silverstein speaks of language, and Bloch speaks of sociality in general, but now, with their help, we arrive at a convergence fundamental to the deep history of human music. A short time ago, I characterized the direction proto-music took as an ordered articulation of social activity that could stand apart from everyday communication. You can see now that I intentionally loaded the phrase, for it can serve also as a working definition of ritual in all its forms, an ordered articulation of social activity that stands apart from everyday communication. My sleight of hand is intended to capture a deep historical process of great importance, for the direction in which proto-music veered as it became musicking not only distinguished it from proto-language becoming language, it also fixed the alliance of proto-music with indexical formalism of all other kinds. The systematizing of indexes that took shape in proto-music bound it from the first with the move towards social complexity that we are now in a position to call by various names, the coalescing of metapragmatic communication, the emergence of transcendental sociality, the final extension of thinking at a distance, or more simply, ritual. Since I've quickly covered a lot of territory, let me pause to take stock. We've reached a point, probably between 100,000 and 60,000 years ago, at which several kinds of complexity of capacity and behavior were together, taking new, heightened forms among Homo sapiens in Africa. These included abstract formalisms in cognition, hierarchies, combinatoriality, transcendental perceptions in the social order, its invisible aspects, and unprecedented complexity in communication. From this matrix, sociality, language, and musicking all assumed their modern natures. The formalized performances of that sociality, rituals of every sort, extended an indexicality by now ancient in the hominin line. We saw this indexicality already in the proto-discourse of Boxgrove half a million years ago. But this indexical emphasis matched one of the two communicative streams that had flowed from proto-discourse more closely than it matched the other. It had more to do with proto-music than with proto-language. So ritual was always closer to music than it was to language. And today, they are joined in human experience, ritual and music, not in serendipitous happenstance, but by virtue of this ancient heritage. Their connection is a default setting in human modernity that stems from a deep, deep history of shared indexical features. I want to put this more strongly still. The formal complexity of musicking is the formalization of certain moments of complex sociality. Here we can once more remember John Blacking, who wrote, "No musical style has its own terms. Its terms are the terms of its society and culture." Except that we register a difference in Blacking, who had little patience for speculation on the ancient emergence of musical capacities. We now uncover deep historical reasons why musicking must, in fact, formalize complex sociality, and we see that society and culture came into their modern forms hand in glove with musicking. The formalization that is ritual, fundamental to the humanly constructed niche, takes musical shape because this was how such formalization came to be in the first place. It was part and parcel of the musicking into being of a human habitation. Now, I'm not ignoring here the obvious fact that ritual formalization is allied with other communicative means than musicking, especially with bodily gesture and with language. My claim, however, is that these other forms are, in ritual, musical at heart. This is true of gesture because formalized bodily motions have always been organized through musicking, in a phenomenon for which the term dance has come to have too narrow a catchment. And it is true of language because it tends in its ritual formalizations to emphasize exactly those prosodic and rhythmic elements minimized in normal speech that bring it close to song, those pragmatic elements that are especially gathered and organized under metapragmatics. So if the formal link of musicking and ritual arose as an ancient extension of thinking at a distance toward invisible realms, that is, if the formal link of musicking and ritual arose as the coalescing of transcendental sociality, then we need to reorder one more of our habits of thought. Just as we tend mistakenly to think that the juncture of music and think of the juncture of music and ritual as a happy frequent coincidence, instead of realizing that ritual was born musical, so we also tend to think that musicking and transcendental perceptions coincide by virtue of special recent high cultural attainments. In European music, such achievements include ecstatic melismatic chant in Christian worship, for example, or the secular musical transcendence of the 19th century, whose chief avatar is Beethoven. And ethnomusicologists can point to many other instances in other cultural locales. But the notion that the coinciding of music and transcendental sociality is something achieved at the end of cultural history has things backwards. The coinciding is instead an aboriginal connection in human culture, uncovered again and again in many elite cultural circumstances, cherished in those circumstances, but not created by them. The bond of musicking with transcendental intuitions was definitive of modern human society at its emergence. I've lingered over the unique history of humanity and its musicking. However, at the beginning of this lecture, I set my sights on something different from an account of human exceptionalism in the world. I promised, in fact, to take hold of human musicking for leverage against exceptionalist views. In this final section of my talk, I'll try to make good on that promise. The question of exceptionalism focuses our sights on the relation of humans to other living things, and in particular, on our relation to other higher animals. Higher animals is, of course, an imprecise designation, but we all register the difference between a sea urchin and a kangaroo. Meditations on this human-animal relation have been legion across the last century, and in a general way, the upsurge stems from the challenge posed by Darwinism. Placing humans among animals seemed to call for a response, given humans' evident differences from other animals. But if these meditations are thus prompted by the evolutionary challenge, it is a striking fact that they hardly ever pause to consider human evolution. You can follow them from Heidegger in the 1920s down to his ambivalent exegetes Agamben and Derrida, or you can follow them in the phenomenological tradition to Merleau-Ponty's last work on animal and human embodiment, or you can follow them into the thicket of animal rights debate in philosophers such as Peter Singer, Martha Nussbaum, and Kelly Oliver, or indeed you can follow them even into the post-humanist positions of Donna Haraway, Carrie Wolfe, and Rosie Ray-Dalty. But in none of these places will you find careful attention to deep human history or biocultural evolution. It's as if all these thinkers and many other kindred ones are determined to address the human-animal question only in the terms set by Aristotelian and Cartesian empiricism, however much they oppose Aristotle and Descartes. To put it more strongly, it's as if they cannot see that Darwinism rendered synchronic accounts of animals feeble in the face of historical change. In this blindness, there must be an overdetermination at work. What is it? If we were to seek a single word answer, it would have to be metaphysics. Recent human-animal thinking, much like pre-Darwinian versions of it in this regard, seems driven to affirm a mysterious, immense distance separating humans from even the highest non-human animals. This distance usually is conceived as an abyss, a chasm that Heidegger opened, that Agamben reconfigures, and that Derrida, even in his anxiety to avoid metaphysics, feeds. That's his word. The abyss is configured in many ways. Its human edge might be given the talismanic name consciousness, something denied to the non-human or granted to it only with caveat and qualification. Or the distance across the abyss might take the form of an ethical responsibility or altruism present in humans but denied to animals, which then might, depending on your position, be a prerequisite for any claim to animal rights. And of course, the distance across the abyss always also measures the space between non-language and language. Exhibit number one for the exceptionalists, as I've said. In all these human capacities, there are imponderables and complexities that science struggles to understand, no doubt. But humanist responses to the struggle have not, on the whole, been helpful. They go on elaborating figures that never seem to move far enough away from a Cartesian soul, or at least far enough away from a special human positioning of the sort that sponsored that soul. Heidegger is the leader of this modern-day mysticism, in my view. Even if we don't doubt the power of his Dasein as an analysis of the human condition, we can see that he has been influential beyond all likelihood in extending his analysis to the non-human. For him, the experience of being in the world is categorically closed to non-human animals. They merely respond to their environment instinctually, all of them, in a seemingly undifferentiated way. There's little room here for the distance and difference between sea urchin and kangaroo. Heidegger was quick to seize on scientific findings when they supported his aim of defining this categorical difference, but if they did not, not to worry. The fact that biology recognizes nothing of the sort, he wrote, is no counterargument against metaphysics. This, to my mind, is unhelpful humanism at its worst. The absence of deep history from this whole tradition of thought on humans and animals results immediately in a misconception and in an irony. The misconception concerns the abyss. Humanists worry over this space between humans and our closest relatives in the world today and seem to regard it as a conundrum, an aporia calling for philosophical explanation. But it is not. Gaps separating kinds of living things are no more than a basic consequence of the dynamics of natural selection, as Darwin already recognized. The missing link is nothing but an artifact of the flattening of history, of our looking out at the world as it exists right now. The links that are invisible in this view come into sight only in a historical diachronic perspective, and this is the work not of ontologists, but of paleontologists. Thus, the misconception. The irony lies in the fact that the metaphysical premises that open the abyss can themselves be seen in historical vantage to emerge from non-metaphysics. It's not even the hardest problem in thinking about human evolution to posit a plausible course toward metaphysics, starting from the first lens of thinking at a distance. And the course can be extended back even behind these. I've tried to outline today how we can do this, from the earliest hominid intuition that a tool might be saved for later, through the dawning of invisible aspects of sociality, right down to Heidegger's flights. And the fact that his metaphysics recognizes no such course is no counter-argument against evolution. Beyond these immediate concerns, deep history grants us another sharper clarity. The solid terms of difference proposed in the human-animal discourse melt in its light. More exactly, they turn out to be forms of sameness. Among kinds of living things, distance is proximity subjected to selective history, nothing more. This applies to the distance between us and our closest relatives in the world today, chimps and gorillas, or between us 40,000 years ago and lingering Neanderthals, but it also teaches us something about much larger distances. We might take as a limit case Heidegger's argument that animals differ categorically from humans because they act only by instinctual pattern response, while we humans do something different. Environmental affordance and constraint, in Heidegger's view, function for animals as disinhibitors, stimuli that elicit fixed reactions from them. The tick, in the famous instance, the tick disinhibited by butyric acid from the sweat glands of mammals, burrows in and begins to suck blood. But there is a fixed response also in all human life. It is a response of fixed flexibility. And this is a historical construct, not a play with words. Through long stretches of hominin evolution, capacities were selected that enabled variable responses to the world. Hominins were not alone in this. We can see that countless other animals also have evolved some such flexibility, especially in mammals and birds. We can think of this flexibility in terms of the tightness of connection between genotype and phenotype, an organism's morphological and behavioral characteristics in its lifeways. The genotype and phenotype of the tick are tightly bound, those of bird and mammal much less tightly. But at a late moment in hominin evolution, in the midst of the dramatic instability of late Pleistocene world climates, and at a tipping point brought on by the matrix of thinking at a distance and social and communicative complexity that I've talked about, at this moment, late in hominin evolution, Hominins surpassed all other lineages in the hardwiring of supple response. Hominins' production of more and more complex cultures altered in certain ways the very patterns of their niche construction, so as to select for an unprecedented loosening of the connection between genotype and phenotype. The result was a cascade in which capacities to make difference came themselves to be selected. Late hominins finally were not merely enabled, but required to create difference in the world. So the fixed pattern characteristic of humans came to be flexible response. This is what is triggered by our disinhibitors. It is in fact all we can do in the world, as we can immediately appreciate, by trying to imagine a human response of utter fixity, the fixity, say, of a tick. To think about this fact, and to think about our place or niche, we need, in other words, a different concept than exceptionalism. We need the concept of an unexceptional exceptionalism. But once we frame this concept, we can see that it applies to the history of life in general, from bacteria to us, from sea urchins to kangaroos. All life is unexceptionally exceptional. Differences are real in the world, but the abyss is illusory. How can the musicking and ritual that arose at the tipping point in hominin evolution help us to supersede the illusion of the abyss? I offer two final observations. First, in their formalized, systematized, and iterated patterns, musicking and ritual are a general outcome in evolution of the fixing of response through natural selection. In this, they are connected to all those less flexible, if not fully fixed, patterns of response evolved in other animals. But in the particulars of our biocultural evolution, the fixing of response manifested as musicking and ritual coalesced as a working of variety within formalized patterns. Fixity and flexibility emerge from the same history. And musicking and ritual, then, are the distinctly human formations that most clearly show the two sides of the evolutionary coin. The second observation requires a bit more development. Let's start again, one more time, with Heidegger. He borrowed his concept of the disinhibitor, the environmental stimulus in animal life, from the ethologist Jakob von Uexkow. But, as Agamben has explained, Heidegger renamed the concept, and he did so to further his own metaphysical ends. He termed it enthemenda, literally an unhemming, whereas Uexkow had called it a Bedeutungsträger, a carrier of meaning. In Uexkow's term, we glimpse possibilities excluded from Heidegger's. Uexkow does not suggest merely an environmental switch turning on instinctual behavior, but instead the organism's active interpreting or reading of environmental meaning. It's because of ideas like this that Uexkow is regarded today as one of the two founders of biosemiotics, a field, by the way, that Heidegger's metaphysics would absolutely foreclose. The co-founder alongside Uexkow of biosemiotics is none other than Charles Sanders Peirce, whose sign categories, icon, index, and symbol we've already encountered. Where is the intersection between Uexkow's and Peirce's ideas? It resides exactly in the realm of sign making. Uexkow's animals read with varying flexibility the environmental signs they have evolved to read. They make sense of the carriers of meaning, the Bedeutungsträger. But for Peirce, sign reading is always an active process of sign making. The organism interacts with something in the world in such a way that it comes to be connected with something else. The organism thus makes the second something the meaning and the first something the sign that points to it. So the semiotic activity of Uexkow's animals is specified then by Peirce. Carriers of meaning are made by organisms. They are not natural kinds waiting to be read. Instead, they're a part of animal niche construction. Wherever signs are found in the animal kingdom, they are the reflection, the revelation of an evolved animal agency for which Heidegger had no patience. And if we follow this biosemiotic reasoning one step farther, we will come back to musicking and to our close. Among certain animals, all those that have any capacity to learn from prior experience, and that includes many animals, one type of sign is preeminent, the index. This is because the index operates by the kinds of pointing, indication, and association that come along with the repeated experience of situations and their causal links. Smoke is an index of unseen fire only for an animal that can learn from having experienced smoke and fire together at an earlier moment. Then, when it smells smoke but sees no fire, it makes the connection and creates the index. Icons are more basic than this and require no learning. Symbols, on the other hand, arise from other kinds of organization among themselves and are probably unique to humans in the world today. By virtue of their organization, symbols form themselves into networks, of which the chief human example is the semantic network of words in modern language. The meaning of indexes in the form that is widespread among animals is less networked than this, more immediate, contiguous, and relational. But as we have seen, this relational operation of the index is the kind of signification native to musicking. And we've seen also that musicking displays a specifically human propensity to systematize the indexes. This systematization builds from arrays of indexes networks somewhat akin to those of symbols, and such networking formed the aboriginal bond that I've described of musicking, ritual, and transcendental sociality. Now, there's no doubt that all this puts an exceptional human stamp on a widely dispersed mode of animal sign-making, indexicality. But to appreciate this is also to see that it is no more than a stamp on that sign-making, a small landmark in the panorama of indexical animal agency in the world. And to appreciate this is to repudiate the idea of the abyss between human and animal, to see musicking and ritual as our own exhibit number one for the unexceptional exceptionalism of humans. In a special way, then, musicking and ritual open a conceptual passage outward from the human to the animal. I've elsewhere called this passage parahumanism in an attempt to weaken the claim on our lexicon of the term posthumanism with its unavoidable whiff of a temporal succession. For the deep historical vantage in which the opening appears does not prophesy a new era so much as it identifies a persisting ancient space that humans have never left behind. This space is the musical habitation with which I began. We share it with many other animals, but not because they too make music. We share it instead by virtue of our common semiotic ways of shaping the world to which we give peculiarly human expression. Merleau-Ponty, opposing Heidegger's metaphysics of the abyss, pointed to this common community of experience, calling it our strange kinship with animals. But his laudable effort was hampered because he too disclaimed evolutionary explanations. We musical humanists might now ask whether a deep history of human musicking might not make our kinships in the world less strange. Thank you very much.
You wouldn't mind using the microphones to ask a question, if anybody has a question. Yes, we have someone
right up the back.
Please come down.
Thank you very much for that wonderfully stimulating talk. And I'd love to read it because I can't confess to have absorbed it in one hearing. But I was struck by your initial distinction you made between everyday communication and other sorts of symbolization. And I started wondering, well, what does everyday communication mean? And to perhaps relate to some of your later argument, if one thinks of birdsong for birds, it's every day. We perhaps, and we know, I think, that they use it for identifying other birds, their offspring, this sort of thing. I don't know if it's a but it's what people tend to pick up. So I wondered if you could apply that your distinction that you made at the very end to the idea of birdsong, which of course humans anthropomorphize in a somewhat romantic way, and we assume birds don't, they just use it for, quote, communication. I wonder if you could perhaps draw it on.
Thank you, it's a wonderful question. Is Hollis here or something? Hollis? Oh, yeah, there you are. Yes, I just yesterday was talking with Paulus over here about a fantastically interesting bird that she is researching in Queensland. Birds do spectacularly interesting things, but let me get to that second and get first back to the question of ordinary communication. The effort, of course, it's a Whitby and ill-defined phrase. When we talk, and indeed the way in which it is ill-defined comes into focus precisely when I start talking about silver scientific pragmatics, because all linguistic discourse, all communication involves higher orders of organization, organizations of index counting, complex organizations that then moves ever so slightly towards what finds its culmination, the silver sign in the ritual, what finds its culmination for me in the ritual in its connection with music. So yes, this is a spectrum, not of course some kind of decisive dichotomy. But the thing about birdsong is absolutely fascinating, and birds are absolutely fascinating. And the fundamental effort needs to be made not exactly as you suggested. It needs to be made not to anthropomorphize the birdsong, but to go in a different direction with it. One of the most fascinating questions about birdsong, to my way of thinking, is that the nature of what is communicated, if you wish to call it that, the semantic content of birdsong, seems to come down to some very, very simple things. More or less, though the stuff about identifying other birds is a little bit unclear, but more or less, this is my land, get off of it, or come make with me, and not too many other messages. But if that's the case, then we need to understand why it is that such huge levels of combinatorial complexity are built into the songs that are taught, by the way, in bird song cultures from generation to generation, in many, many different species, and especially the one that Paulus is researching is a great example of this. So, yes, bird song is a tremendously interesting example. It is an example of huge mystery, but it is also an example of the capacity of indexes to be marshaled together into very, very complex structures. That's where its fascination seems to lie, most of all. The other fascination of it, also quite consequential, has to do with why all the complexity for this level of communication, unless, of course, we've got the level of communication wrong. There is more and more evidence coming online all the time about corvids in particular, and that is for the bird family in general, and the fantastic interesting things that they do with tools. Songbirds that are doing fantastic and interesting things with complex combinatorial structures. Birds are up to fascinating stuff, there's no question. I don't know that, I think I got off the track with your question, but I hope that the question of ordinary language, ordinary communication versus something other was clarified a little bit there.
I think we've reached the end.
One more, there's a hand up. One more, just
there's in one more?
Yes. Yeah, yes, you, yes.
Do you have a favorite Beatles album?
Do you have a favorite Beatles album?
I was on my exercise machine listening recently to a lot of Beatles, and I suddenly decided that Nietzsche's The Case of Wagner, which is a great tearing apart of Wagner that Nietzsche wrote late in his career, and it begins by sort of saying, you will be surprised to know that I have heard Bizet's masterpiece, he's referring to Carmen, for the 20th time. And he goes on sort of like saying how wonderful Carmen is at the expense of Wagner. And it suddenly occurred to me that I was listening to Abbey Road, an album that I, as a Beatles fan, when the Beatles were just putting these things out, as a very young person, loved to disparage for being overproduced, for being too much Paul McCartney and too little John Lennon and so on and so forth. I was listening to it recently, and I was just blown away by the complexity of it and the wonder of that album. However, and this is the answer to your question, I can listen to any Beatles album almost, and the same thing happens. So what can I say? I don't have any Beatles albums.
Well, Gary, thank you so much for an absolutely fantastic lecture. I know that it draws on some of your published work, but I hope that we'll see you continue this to develop this line of thinking and being in the world. I really appreciate it. And on behalf of the Conservatorium, I'd like to give you one gift that I hope you'll take home and one gift that I hope you won't.